So here I go. Welcome, everybody, to a new edition of the Art Business podcast. I think there's been a little bit of a delay on this new podcast of several weeks. That's because I was on vacation. But here we are back with I sometimes say this, but this really is a very special guest as far as I'm concerned on a personal level. Steve Sabella is an alumnus of the MA Art Business program that I'm program director for at Sotheby's Institute of Art in London. Steve is a practicing artist. He was born in Jerusalem in 1975 and has lived in Berlin, continuing to practice his art since 2010. Steve has achieved various awards in the art world that we might talk about later, or certainly I'll put the links on the podcast page. His art has been is in various important collections all across the world, including the British Museum in London, the Arab Museum of Modern Art in Doha in Qatar, and the Arab World Institute Paris. And there are other institutions and private collections that his work is in. And Steve tells me that he's currently got five exhibitions on, including one at the Venice Architectural Biennale, which I'm going to just ask him to say some words about before we talk about some of his favorite art and so on, and then get to talk about his book. I'm just going to ask Steve, because I know that my current students are about to visit the Architectural Biennale. So Steve, can you talk about your work in the Biennale?
Yes. Hi, David. Nice to talk to you again.
Yeah, very good to talk to you.
You were my professor at school, just to remind everyone. Yes, I have five exhibitions, including Venice, the Architecture Biennial exhibition, Time, Space, Existence. And I'm showing The Great March of Return, which is basically a collage I did of over 1,000 photos of photos I took from five journalists from Gaza. When they documented the demonstrations or the right of return at the border for almost 2 years. And these photos for me looked biblical, you know, almost like Renaissance art. And when I collaged them together, they looked almost like Renaissance art. And now it's being exhibited at this exhibition there. And they are on a round circle, 2 meters diameter, on a motor, and it's rotating. So it almost looks like a spaceship, like the time factor, just to mirror, you know, how much Palestinians have been living under occupation since a long time. And I have another show in Turin and in Reggio Emilia called Masters of Photography from the collection of Arts AP Museum, which is, they also have my art. And one in Morocco, Rabat, in the Modern and Contemporary Art Museum. And yesterday I opened one in Paris at the Institut du Monde Arabe. As well, so I'm quite busy with shows.
where is the exhibition in Torino?
In Torino, it's at Metro Quadro Gallery. It's a gallery I've been working with since 2008. I met the owner on the plane, and back then I had a big show while I was doing my first master's, and I exhibited my finished work in April, where it was due in July. I was just ready for the work, and on the plane, two old people asked me, what have you been doing in Torino? I said, I've been exhibiting at Palazzo Piozzo. And then the gallerist behind me said, did you say Palazzo Piozzo? I said, yes. He said, it's next to my house. And it just happened that he was opening a gallery that winter. And he asked me if I would like to be in the first show. And since then, a very special relationship developed between me and the gallerist, Metro Quadro, Marco Sasson. And up to this day, I like to exhibit with him because we met in the air and we remained in the sky.
Brilliant. Yeah. Actually, you probably got other stories about who you meet when you're traveling. I've certainly had some events like that. I can't remember when you were on the MA Art Business in London. Did we visit Torino? Because we have been visiting Artissima, the art fair. Did we go there with you?
Absolutely. Yes, I remember.
Yeah. So you'd been introduced to the Torino at that point, but maybe you'd been before.
Yeah, maybe it was a bit, it was the year before when I've been to Torino for the first time. Mm. And since then, probably I've been to Italy over 30 times. I actually, to my record, there are almost 24 exhibitions in Italy from that point.
Wow, that's incredible. Do you have any exhibitions outside of Europe, like in the United States, North America?
Yes, I was invited to be like one of the main artists for the first biennial of contemporary Arab photography in Houston, organized by PhotoFest. Mm-hmm. That exhibition also toured to the Middle East, And also, I remember had in 2009 a show in Manhattan through a Nicholas Robertson Gallery back then, but they closed doors after a few years.
Yes.
And Chicago, and I had a few exhibitions rotating back then. I mainly exhibit in Europe and the Middle East, I have to say, a lot in the Middle East.
What about the Southern Hemisphere, like Latin America, Southeast Asia, perhaps?
Yeah, I've had several contacts. I'm working on it to expand to those regions over time.
Excellent.
At the moment, I'm more on the Middle East and Europe.
Excellent.
And America.
Great. And Steve, I think you've got a slight, as listeners, regular listeners will know, I start with this rather embarrassing questions about what's your favorite city, what's your favorite rural location. Steve is going to do this through art. So over to you, Steve.
Yes, go ahead. What's your first question?
Your favorite urban location and any reason for it?
Okay, urban. I live in Berlin and, you know, I'm mesmerized by Berlin for different reasons. It has like great places where people chill like you have never seen before. And one of them is this lake called Plötzensee. It's actually, you can walk from the center of Berlin to this lake, like half an hour, and suddenly you discover this magic. And those who are now seeing the screen, they can see what I'm doing. So it's a collage of hundreds of images of this lake. But when you look at it, it feels like one space. I mean, it's hard to describe with words, and that's why I use images. But maybe David, you can say a few things about it. It looks like almost like Greek mythology, taking us back in time. When I've shown this work in Italy, they reviewed it as from Bosch to the Bible. You know, they called it.
I mean, there's lots of Greek myths, as you know, about pools and the spirits in water pools, like Hylas and the nymphs. This picture reminds me of where the nymphs inviting him into the water.
Yeah.
And
rural, I have to say the volcanic landscape of Mount Etna is one of my favorite places. So I also did the collage of this landscape, and both works are part of a series called On Earth. So this is a collage of Mount Etna. And if you look carefully, you will see like small people in the landscape.
Oh,
like
yes.
Here in the very middle, you see a small girl going uphill. So it reminds you a little bit of Jeff Wall artworks, but with a twist. It's like a dream artwork. If you look, it feels like a dream.
It's fantastic, a lot of your art, Steve. One of the reasons I really like it is because it has this ambiguity between. It looks like traditional oil brush strokes, quite abstract when you get up close, and yet it's all done through the medium of photography.
Yeah, I often say I use my camera like a brush. You know, I wish my hands were able to use brushes and paint, but the truth is I can't. So I learned how to use my camera like a brush and bend images, take the color or extract it from images and to create a new reality. Often, I have to say maybe a short story. I had a collector once had my work, and after 3 years, I visit the collector and she tells me, "What a lovely painting you have." I said, "That's photography." She said, "Are you kidding me? I thought for 3 years that was a painting."
Absolutely.
That's
interesting, isn't it? Because you will know this, Steve, as well as I do, that I would say only in the new millennium have we started to see artists using photography as a medium because of technological revolutions and the increasing high resolution that you can create. They've been challenging people like Andreas Gursky. They've been challenging painters, which a lot of the students listen to this are not of that age group. You know, they've only just been born then. But I think you'll agree with me that there's
Absolutely.
Been a big revolution in artists who use photography.
I remember like 23 years ago when the cameras were like 3.5 megabytes, you know, we were like celebrating, you know, and today iPhone is like 49 million pixel and the Hasselblad is like 100 million pixel. And I think it's still going to go on and on. And for me as an artist who also uses digital photography, that's absolutely great. It allows me to dig deeper into details and extract what I want without suffering image resolution. Okay.
Yes, and presumably you can also do other things that you can do with digital media, which you can mix them up in ways that are quite difficult with traditional analog methods.
Yeah, but you see also, as I see the world going so much digital, I do see also a return to analog, because now we are lost into a world of images where everyone is becoming a photographer, but not everyone is a photo artist.
Absolutely.
Right. One of your questions, maybe you asked me what advice you want to give to photo artists. I would say focus on developing your language as a photo artist, not on creating single images. Now, everyone's an expert in creating one Instagram great shot, but not everyone knows how to put many images together to create a language. And this actually will differentiate between artists and just image makers of single images, you know, here and there.
That's a great, I love that definition. I'm always very careful, and I always warn my students off saying, this is a photographic artist. I say, no, you mean an artist who happens to use photography as their medium.
Absolutely, and that's how I define myself. I don't like the term like I'm a photographer because I don't see myself accordingly, even though like I did it professionally from 1997 till 2007, where I worked as a professional photographer for UNICEF, UNDP, UNRWA, OCHA, Save the Children, and what not. But back then, you know, I started early on in my, when I started, there was one famous photographer in the country in Palestine, maybe one. His name was Garo. But Garo never knew what hit him when I entered the market. I entered with, because I entered with a new portfolio when I just finished my first degree in art photography. And the portfolio looked really good. It focused on life. And technically, it was very fine. I remember telling my partner back then, who was the subject of my first book, the love story. I tell her, now let's see, once I show my work, how long is it going to take till I get my first assignment? And guess what, David? It took a few days to get the first assignment. And in 6 months, I was branded as the youngest and most professional photographer around. So I did it for 10 years, and most of the images from the United Nations had like my name on them, even though New York complained once to the UN agencies in Palestine, Israel, why every image that comes out of Palestine, Israel has a Steve Sabella name on it. And their answer was simply, he was the best. He's the best around. But you see, I got, even though I was so established as a professional photographer, it was always art, my passion. So I had to leave this career, leave it behind, and went to live in London to seek my first master's, and so that I can only focus on my art rather than my professional photography.
By professional photography and the work you did for UNICEF in Palestinian territory, I think between 1998 and 2007, it was kind of what we would call photojournalism rather than what we would call primarily art.
I would call it art photography because they hired me as an artist to do artistic photographs for their magazines.
Yeah, so a little bit like a war artist.
It was always my style. They asked me like to do an assignment and I did it my way. Otherwise, I would not have done it, you know? But you know, there was a price to that. I got kidnapped, you know, in Gaza, you know, at
Oh, goodness. Well, that doesn't surprise me. You hear these stories all the time. Steve, just coming back to so that the listeners can know a little bit more about your aesthetic interests. Do you have a favorite building anywhere, like piece of architecture or architect?
You know, growing in the old city of Jerusalem, I'm fascinated with walls, but not the separation wall, with old city walls. There is something magical about how they contain society and how there is a life behind these walls. Yes. And I think Jerusalem is one of those few cities in the world where behind its walls is so vibrant. There is life going on, where in some areas, like let's say in France, Carcassonne or Narbonne, I can't remember, they have a wall, but it's very touristic, okay? But in the old city, you have so many writers came to life, artists, musicians, thinkers, I don't know, many, many things. And I love the old touch, you know, it's probably 600 years old, the wall in Jerusalem, I think, 600, if I'm not mistaken, 500 to 600. And on the other hand, you know, I also like new architecture, you know. I'm not like only stuck in the past.
No,
I like futuristic buildings too. So maybe the work also of Zoha Hadid, this spacey outlook of buildings, also inspires me. So I don't want to live in between. It's either here or there. So go find a place for me to live. I don't know.
I remember actually talking about Zaha Hadid. She, for the students listening, she studied at the Architectural Association, which is next to Sotheby's Institute of Art in Bedford Square. And also there was one year when we used to take our students to Chatsworth, where there was a Sotheby's sale of modern contemporary art. And her her prize-winning pavilion, Zaha Hadid's prize-winning pavilion that had been at Serpentine one year. You know, there's a prize for a pavilion at the Serpentine for every summer for people to meet and have coffee and discuss. That was actually for sale, amazingly, and it was there on the green in front of Chatsworth Barot House. So we did quite a lot of, we were quite interested in Zaha Hadid. And, you know, the students are going to the architectural biennale this year, and it can be quite difficult for us to rationalize that because they say, oh, we're doing art, not architecture. And I remind them of people like Zaha Hadid, that there's a lot of great architects, artists who are working between both forms, like between photography and traditional art media, if you like. So also the Biennale is considered by Venice as, you know, the Biennale isn't just art. It's just that we fetishize the art. They see the Biennale as art, dance, film, architecture, and all being very, very equal. They hate it when people all come in for the art and then ignore the other forms. So, and many students who've been to the Architectural Biennale before, they often come back saying, actually, this was far more avant-garde in terms of philosophical ideas and useful ideas for architecture for poor people in poor countries or countries with sanctions like Iran and so on. You know, they see the ideas, the political ideas in architecture are as in the forefront as in the Art Biennale.
Well, I agree with you. All disciplines are interconnected. There is no way we can look at architecture without looking at the history of art itself, you know? Any good architect or artist also has to look at architecture and urban design to get inspired. And I can't see myself just looking at visual art to be inspired. Actually, what inspires me is everything we see on planet Earth, you know? Yes. Like life itself, all its ingredients with all its forms is very inspiring. And
Totally agree. And all of this, I suspect many of our listeners, because they're that kind of generation, late millennials, early Gen Z, mindfulness is a big thing there. And one of the things mindfulness does, of course, is to make you aware of every sound and everything that you see is important to you. So it's a really good development, that, I think. Coming back to your what you said about walls, it reminds me, I'm a guest lecturer talking about ancient Roman architecture. It's the Bartlett School of Architecture connected to University College London. And it's a very good architectural school as well. And the first assignment that they give them when I'm speaking is talk about walls as architect, you know, talk about the materials and what walls are there for. And apparently it elicits some amazingly imaginative responses. So we kind of ignore walls a lot of the time, but walls are, if you think about it, they can, as you could say, they can be divisive, like in dividing territory in Jerusalem. They can be, and the Berlin Wall, which is there in Berlin now, but they can also be incredible structures that have other kind of magical meanings or poetic meanings, you know. So it's interesting that you choose walls.
Yeah, but the old ones, the ones we construct for humanity, not the ones to divide people.
Absolutely. And then, Steve, do you listen to any music when you're working, or do you know?
It's funny that you say that. You know, the work behind me, you see, I can just show it to you.
Yes, you know? Amazing.
I listened to Jan back then when this was done when I was in London, and I was listening to Jan Tiersen back then, the composer of the movie Emily. Okay, I listened to his one song in on loop 500 at least 500 times while working on this artwork. Now listen to what happened. A musician came to my house in London, and at first glance, she looks at this artwork and she says, when I look at this artwork, it feels like I'm listening to Jan Tiersen. I said, wow, how did you manage to retranslate my visual notation, which was inspired by listening to the music, again back into audio? And then I asked her, which song do you think I did? And she said, I think it was the piano song, number 5. And she was spot on. Yes, wow. David, when I do art, I'm fanatic about listening to music. Like now I'm more into techno, living in Berlin, obviously. I switched to techno, so I cannot create art without listening to music. And I put it on trance, and I like to repeat the song sometimes, hundreds of times, till my brain dissolves. And this way, when I create, I'm floating. So, and the writer of my monograph, Professor Hubertus von Amelungsen from the Academy of Arts in Germany, actually, he puts his thesis from the beginning. I want to prove to you that Sabella's art has music notations in it. And he explains from the beginning why and how and all these things, contrapoint and all this. Things I don't understand, I just do them by intuition, you know, by working. But he had a theory for it from the beginning that my work is also musical, not only painting.
That's amazing. So music is obviously very important to you, but it's the way you use it that is different. You know, some people just say, oh, I usually have like Debussy piano music in the background because it's relaxing and gentle and beautiful. And then, you know, and then I get on with my own work. But it sounds as though it becomes part of your process of working.
Absolutely. And it changed over the years, you know, like in the 80s, 70s, I was listening to different things. Now I'm focused on techno and it inspires me very much. You can see it as abstract art techno because it has like no form. It's floating in any direction. And I like that it's not fixed, you know. That's why I can create freely with it.
And do you have any kind of playlists on any platforms like Spotify, or aren't you a member of Spotify?
Yes, absolutely, like on Spotify.
So do you have a playlist that you could give a link for?
I could, but it's like actually mixed this playlist, because when I like a song, it could be like 50 songs are techno, then a little bit soft, and then a little bit hard. It depends on the mood, you know, on the style. Yeah. I mean, I can share maybe with you like a few songs.
I'm sure some of the listeners would. I know that they've always got their what are they called, AirPods in their ears. So, you know.
And I go clubbing a lot in Berlin. As you know, we just live in the city of all cities when it comes to clubbing. It's, for the listeners who know Berghain, it's my temple every Sunday. So I get very inspired. Yeah.
That's great. That's a really, really good thing to do. I don't think the mindfulness thing we've talked about as being very healing. And I don't think we dance enough these days, you know.
Somebody nicknamed me once the dancer of life, and I think I used it in my book.
And Steve, turning now to kind of art, that strange word art, can you recall the time when you suddenly realized there was such a thing as art? And, you know, because it's quite a difficult concept to explain to people, I think. I think if aliens came down to our world and we said, what's this thing called art? And we tried to explain to them, it'd be quite difficult. Can you remember the moment when you became aware that there was such a thing as art?
Yeah, let me start maybe when I was 12. My father was a camera collector. He had like Zenith and Konica and many other cameras. And I was playing with them, flirting with the cameras at young age and making photos. And from maybe 12 to 16, you know, I became very good at making film images, you know, photos. I didn't see it as art back then. I just saw them as good images, okay? Maybe when I graduated from school, high school, I was looking for an art university in Palestine. We had almost nothing. So I was looking into Israel, and even there, I didn't know much. So I landed on Bitzel El school. But of course, they want a portfolio and they want you to speak Hebrew, which I didn't speak. So I learned Hebrew very quickly. Probably in 2 weeks, I broke the record of learning a language in 2 weeks.
Wow.
But then I started to make my portfolio. I would say my first touch to understand, you know, what is art making was making my portfolio for Bitzel El, where I actually put like in the studio, my own studio, lights together to create like cosmos, like starry night, you know, through my eyes. And that was my portfolio. I would say this was my first attempt to create something different, to transform. Maybe art is to transform something into something else, to give it a new identity, a new look. And this, I felt, was the art process back then. Transformation, you know?
Yeah, no, absolutely. As I understand it, because I spoke with you about this before we started the recording, that we're actually partnering in a very small way with Beth Salel in Jerusalem, which for the listeners is a very important, that they do an MFA in studio art. Steve told me that they rejected him, and yet now he's, as you can see, he's this very well-known artist. But that happens to a lot of, I think, great authors, artists, you know, that kind of story. But I think we might talk about this later in connection with your books, with your new book, Steve.
David?
Can you hear me?
David?
Yeah, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, you're back. It was interrupted. Now you're back. Yeah.
Oh, no problem. No, I was just saying that we're in the summer, in fact, we're going to give the opportunity, it's an option for our students who are art business students, to work with usually emerging artists and help them with their understanding of the art market and the art world. And that is the main subject of Steve's book that we're going to come to in a moment, his new book. But as I understand it, they now teach in English, rather when you applied, they were teaching in Hebrew.
I think they both ways, they can do Hebrew or English, and you can submit, I think, in English your assignment.
Okay.
If I'm not mistaken. I think it's a very good school. It's very competitive. That it's maybe minus for some people. Like it's not intimate enough to interact with the students like one-to-one or with the teachers. Like teachers are absent when you work in the dark room or not around you. So I went for my second option, which was the Jerusalem School of Photography in Musrara. Yes. And I remember like at the interview, there were almost, I think, four or five panel people. And I entered that room and my first thing telling them, I said, let's go on with it because I'm not going to be accepted. Let's just finish it, you know? I said, why do you think you won't be accepted? I said, come on, let's be real, you know? I am a Palestinian from the other side and you're not going to accept me here. I was the first Palestinian to be accepted at this school, you know? And funny enough, they did accept me and I graduated with distinction. And up to this day, Avi Sabak, the director of the school, is very fond of me and he talks to people about my success story, you know, that happened later. And I'm very happy actually I went to this school. The difference between this one and Bitzel is here is you have all the teachers around you all the time. It's like a nice community, always interacting, asking. So you learn way more than in Bitzel. This is what actually several students leave Bitzel to study at Musrara because of this intimacy. So the universe has no wrong answers. It is what it is.
Yes.
Yeah, it is what it is. I would have liked Bitzel because they have the degree, like the formal bachelor degree, where Musrara at that point was still a new school. It didn't offer it yet. And that's why I went to do at SUNY to complete my bachelor degree in visual art so that I can do my first master's in London.
Yeah, that's for the listeners, that's SUNY in New York.
Yes.
I'm sure most of them know that, but it's the New York place. So you then went to New York and then you came back over to London. I think you went to Westminster, the University of Westminster.
Yeah. I had the Schiebning scholarship. I don't know if you know Schiebning scholarship to do the first masters, but I already had in my mind to do two masters because when I said I don't want to do professional photography any longer, I had to think, how can I live from my art? So that's why the second master's had to be on something practical. I was thinking to do curating, but then I met a friend of mine. He's a known artist. And he said, Steve, if you want to do curating for your second master's, your energy will pour for others. Why don't you consider something more that can benefit you? Then I was thinking, what about this art business course at Sotheby's? He said, you know what? I think this is spot on, good for you. It will teach you the tools how to live in your art and progress. And this is what I did. So I went for the second master's, but as listeners know, Sotheby's is not cheap. So where to come up, you know, but this is a huge tuition and living in London back then. So I took a bank loan. I remember like £10,000. I said, let me start with £10,000. I'll figure out the rest. I had no idea, David, I'm going to pay the tuition by December. I just want you to know. But then I had a show in Paris. Funny enough that you say at the Institut de Montserrat, which today they are amongst the biggest collectors of my art. They have 20 artworks. So back then it was maybe my first show at the Institut de Montserrat. And there was a man, a lawyer, who never collected art in his life, who has never understood what art is about. But then I find out later that the five artworks he saw of mine, they were called In Exile, they touched him very much and they mirrored his reality and his life in front of him. So I went to a party to speak with somebody who happened to be an Asian to tell her his story, how much he was touched. And she told him, let me find out who the artist is and see, maybe we can buy this work. He said, really, you can buy such work? She told him, absolutely. So the agent contacts me and guess what, David? December, when I was still doing the master's at Sotheby's, £30,000, I sold those artworks and I paid the whole tuition of Sotheby's at once.
I think I remember you telling me that story at the time saying, I hadn't said this, but I was pretty destitute and suddenly, and one of my main memories of you, Steve, was I used to organize this, we used to organize a Christmas carol service, like a Christian liturgy, if you like, with you know, the traditional, but the students loved it. We used to go back to the Institute for wine and mince pies and sometimes their family would be there and you brought your family. And do you remember we were listening to the carol service in the Hortsmore Blooms Church,
George's
Bloomsbury. Beautiful building. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Very, very super, super nice times. I lived in the center of London, actually, very close to the British Museum, Russell Square.
Yeah.
Maybe some people know Good Enough College. You know.
Oh yes. Yes, we did teach there for 1 year. Amazing. It wasn't a great place to teach. It wasn't, the room wasn't great, but the place was nice.
Yeah, well, they have nice rooms. Maybe they didn't give you the nice room, so let's speak with them. It's a postgraduate house, yeah, for master's and PhD students. And it's just very close to the British Museum. And this is where I lived for almost 2 years till I moved to Angel.
Great. So you know, we'll come to your book in a moment, which is all of, which is in some ways connected with your experience of studying art business, you know, in London. But first, I just wanted you to talk about perhaps a more controversial book, which is a kind of autobiography you published in 2016 called The Parachute Paradox. And I did ask you if you could explain to listeners what you mean by parachute paradox. And I'm aware that this is a political response coming, but, you know, I don't want to, I think everybody should have their voice. So tell us about that book and its background and what you were writing about.
Well, there are facts in life. I was born in Jerusalem under Israeli occupation, and there is nothing I can do about that, about this fact. So I felt I had a calling, you know, what it means to live under Israeli occupation and what it means to liberate the self from it. And I managed in 2013 to drip all Israeli occupation from my blood and feel I'm living as a free man. So it feels like the hero's journey, like what it, I calling, like to tell the world, to share my success story about how I liberated myself. So I called it the parachute paradox. Why? Once I was in a tandem jump parachuting in Haifa. And as you, a tandem jump, you have somebody on your back to protect you, you know, to make sure that you land. I know, and this happened to be an Israeli. And this is the metaphor I want to give. Like, it feels like there is an Israeli on the back of every Palestinian. As you know, we don't have peace, and I doubt we will ever have peace. I want that we have peace, but it feels that we don't. So my quest was how to unbuckle myself and do this jump from the air and land and survive. So that's the paradox. You are in the air, you should feel free, but actually you don't. You are controlled by ropes like a marionette. So that's my paradox. And how I managed to solve it, want to read the book and see how I found my way.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, I'll give the details of the book, you know, in the podcast text. And I was just thinking, it kind of, you know, this is a more common, I think, philosophical occurrence than you might think. I'm even thinking of someone like Jesus Christ, the story of Jesus Christ, where he's basically trying to free himself and arguably a lot of other people from the Jewish and the Roman rule at the time, and he falls foul of both of them in the end. But you know, he manages, I think, to show that you can actually live in this nation and still speak out and be a free agent to a certain extent.
Well, the book received recognition, and it won 2 awards for best memoir. And
absolutely,
also read by Israelis, and even a rabbi in New York praised the book very much for its search for understanding and liberation in a way that makes sense to everyone. You see, what can do and then except tell our story? And I wanted to tell my story as honestly as possible, and nobody can come after you and say, hey, what are you writing about? Okay, I use the language of life, you know. I like to use words that speak about life, not about death. And I think this is what makes the book stand out, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. And I must confess that I haven't read the book, but I've been sent your new book, which we're going to talk about now, and I'm so impressed by the new book, just on a very personal level. I'm not being biased here. I think it's amazing, and I think there's nothing like this that's been published yet. We're going to talk about it now, but I will also certainly hunt down your Parachute Paradox and read it. So basically, for those of you who are looking at the YouTube, this is Steve's new book, and you'll notice it's called The Artist's Curse. But look at the colouring of the word curse, and you'll see it's actually really clever. It's like a binary idea that there is a curse with the white S. If you take the S out, you've also got the cure. And Steve's book is very much about that. So basically, it without giving too much away, because I want Steve to talk about this. In fact, I'm going to ask you, Steve. You know, this is constructed around almost like reading a daily reading. There are other books like that. I've actually got a book on my bookshelf called readings from Stoic philosophy one day a year, where you read, you know, Marcus Aurelius's Meditations, or Zeno, the ancient Greek Stoic, or Cicero, people, the great Stoic philosophers, and you read a page a day. And this has been organized like that, giving an artist just a little bit of information each day to ponder upon. And it begins with a kind of quite negative thing about what it's like being an artist in the art world and the art market. But it always comes up with something positive, which is what I really love about it. It's not just a kind of nasty critical. I've met so many artists who just get very bitter about the art world and the art market, but you try and find a cure for that. So can I, over to you now, if you want to speak more about this new publication.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot to talk about the book.
And Steve, if you want to read from it, I'd really like you to pick some pages to help illustrate what you're saying. Sorry to interrupt.
No, you're not interrupting. There is a lot to speak about this book. And as you said, the title is The Artist's Curse, and it could be The Artist's Cure. And even me, it took me time to see the cure in the curse. But let me just start saying why I created this book. I think back in 2016 or something like that, I was making a lot of good income, you know, from art. Like the sales were like going very well. And living in Germany, and my accountant miscalculated my income tax, even though I was paying tens of thousands every year for several years. But since he filed once every 3 years, suddenly I got a massive bill by income tax in Germany that you need to pay this in 2 weeks. Kidding me? Like, what are you going to bring now this like huge, I don't know, I can remember, 50,000 euro like in 2 weeks? And this is when I went for a GoFundMe campaign, right? And for the GoFundMe campaign in 6 months, lucky me, it brought 96,000 euro. But for it to succeed, I started writing every day a curse, you know, to attract people, to support my campaign. And this, I remember writing at least 250 curses at the time. And it actually succeeded in bringing me the 96,000 euro at the time. But I didn't finish the book because it's like, you know, it also has its own story to tell. It took me 5 years to finish the book, and I now finished it. And as you said, there is always a way out. I cannot just look at, the answer is always right there in front of us. The question is, why don't we see it? And what tools are we learning how to get better at what we do, whether in art or in business, in art market? Things happen, but what are the things I want to do now to go forward in life? So I wanted to be focused and to the point. I know all these books about the artist way, the artist life, all these things, but they are full of clutter. I want the text that's straight to the point, design that works. So I also designed the book myself, and I wanted to create parallels between the pages, left and right. Sometimes it's funny, you know, if you look at the left and the right side. Maybe let me just write, yeah, absolutely, like something like that. Okay, maybe like curse 37. And I remember with Sotheby's going to Tate to see the archive, the thousands, the hundreds of thousands of artworks in Tate archives. So curse 37 is called the Art Cemetery. I was once on tour to view the archive of tens of thousands of artworks in Tate Modern's museum collection in London. I remember the endless rows and stacks of artworks shelved up to the ceiling in all shapes and forms. The smell of paint, varnish, fabric, earth, elephant dung, and other chemicals still lingers in my nose and upsets my stomach. When I asked, how often do these artworks see the light of day? The cemetery warden answered, almost never. At that point, I wondered why I was doing art and why many artists pushed to have their works buried in museums. This taught me to be at peace when collectors hang my art in living rooms. I mean, the cure for this curse, like, I'm happy actually, like the artwork you see behind me, that people can see it. It's alive. It sees the light. Guests can come and see it. But actually, why artists are fighting to be in museums all the time? Yes, it's great for your CV. But actually, is it great for your art? So this made me appreciate, you know, people when they come and say they want to buy my work, and I would give them the priority compared not to the museum, because art is meant to be seen, not meant to be buried. Okay, so or curse, for example, 20.
Actually, just Steve, while you find the next page, just to reflect on something you've said there, I'll remind listeners that something. I mean, and this The last time I heard the statistic was about 10 years ago when I took some of our art business students down the Old Kent Road to the Tate Repository, which is an amazing place to visit. And they told us that only 4% of the works that Tate owns are ever on display, including being exhibited around the world. Yes. So there's an awful lot that we never see anyway. And I just wanted to agree with Steve. I mean, I don't know whether I ever said to you, I tend to say to my students every year, I really don't like museums. There's something very, you know, I don't like that. I mean, I love some of the work in the museums if I can filter out the fact it's a museum. So when I'm in the National Gallery, I found myself actually crying in front of like a religious altarpiece, thinking, I want to see that in its set, in its location, in a church in Florence. I don't want to see it on rather sterilized on the wall and often mutilated by the art market. They often divide up altarpieces to smuggle them in smaller pieces and out of the country. And I just find museums pretty sterile, actually, places on the whole. Sometimes there's some wonderful curated exhibitions where I learn a lot, but I it's a paradox, isn't it? Because if it's hanging on the wall, as that one is behind you now, you have to be invited by Steve to come and look at the work. And that means it's not for public access. I get that argument, but I think there is also an argument for that private ownership of some of the works, so long as some of the works are also in public museums.
Yeah, but don't forget people like, forget my work. Yeah, if you buy, let's say, my work or hang it, you will have guests coming to visit your house, even though they're limited, but still it sees the eyes of people.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Anyway, regarding the book, I always like to share knowledge. You know, my life is an open book. I can't see my life like, given I'm an artist, my art is about my life, you know. So I've been doing art since at least 1994. So you can see the art as the pages of my life. Now, everything I learned, I also like to share. And this book is about sharing my knowledge, the success, the failures, even though there are no failures in life, everything that I've learned in the art market, in the art world. And I say it with honesty and straightforward. And I've been getting like nice reviews lately by artists. And one of them yesterday, I don't know her, artist from the UK, she sent me by Instagram that she loves the book so much. It shatters that illusion that artists live with negativity. And this book is like fixes you to create art and feel good about it. So I like it when it influences people on this level. Anyway, you can see this book as a memoir, like my first book, because it starts with the curse number one. It's called nature. Artists are born. And second one, nurture. Artists are made. And so on. So the question is, if you are made or born, only history and time will tell. And if you go to the last curses of the book, you know, to give it like an ending, curse 364, the resurrection. Artists can always be reborn.
And we agree on that.
Yeah, and then the last curse, 365, a new life, artists die. And this is where Sotheby's and the others come in, because after they die, people start to look at the art again. Absolutely. You know, and give it a new value, a new valuation, a new look. This book, you can see it and you can read one page, like every day, one curse, but I didn't intend it to be like that. But some people I do see, they are doing it like this. But actually, if you read it from the beginning to the end, like quickly on one go, like 3 hours, I think it affects you in a different way, because then you realize, whoa, what's happening here? It's like taking you from one dimension to another. Some people say that I'm not consistent, let's say, with the feelings. I said, but what is consistent in life? Sometimes you feel high, sometimes you feel down. And if you are fixed about how you want to go forward every time in the same way, then you did not learn anything. That's why curses are sometimes different, even though they are about the same topic, but I learned how to look at them from different perspectives, from different angles. And this one gave me, for example, a lot of ability to navigate the art world, and the art world is a maze. It has many closed doors. It doesn't matter what, if you are a small artist or a medium artist or a big artist, you know, young artist, small problems, medium artist, medium problems, big artist, huge problems. We all have issues, you know, nobody, you know, has it easy, you know, but I can see like many artists competing for, let's say, to reach that destination. What is that destination? You know, I ask myself, my destination at the end of the day is to make art. So is to free my time as much as possible to make art. Maybe curse 100 actually summarizes the I call it the curse 100, which is the artist need to sell art to earn a living. Yeah, the artist need to sell art to earn a living. And I wish it were different, that we don't have to sell our art, but that's the reality of it. So some people assume, why are you focusing on the art market? I said, yes, how can I not focus on the art market? As an artist, I need to survive. Can you guarantee to me a salary? I tell my collectors, give me 10,000 euro a month, and they will not care about anything else. But who's going to give you the 10,000 euro? Nobody, right?
Well, in the Renaissance, of course, artists were often lured away from Italy to work for like the Holy Roman Emperor. I'm thinking of Tintoretto. And they offer them like a food and accommodation in their palace and a kind of stipend. And I'm thinking, let's have a look at the work they created then. And often it is less creative. They dry up a bit because it's all coming too easy to them.
Yeah. So this book like gives you ideas how even to earn money also like next to art so that you can also focus on your art, but also gives you tools how to handle people, you know, stagnation, artist block if you have it, things that you don't think about that you should care about in your later years when you become like more established. You know, we don't look at these things like insurances, shipments, all these small things, you know, that are very important for a successful artistic career.
Yeah, we do more, by the way, on logistics now. We even started an MA in art logistics, which didn't get enough people because they said it was too niche. People wanted to do the broad business, but we now have logistics as an elective. Quite a lot of our students go into logistics as a job, but it's a headache, and it's something that artists. By the way, you said something there. It's something that artists shouldn't really need to have to spend time on, you know. But so, you said something very interesting just now, to me anyway, about artist block. I mean, I've heard of writer's block, where a writer, and I get this when I'm writing academic chapters, I just don't know what to write next, and it's called writer's block. What is artist block, Steve?
Well, artist block is like when you, this is one example. Some people complain, let's say, if I don't have a studio, I cannot create art. And in one of the courses, I say, your studio is where you are, wherever you are. In the past, when people asked me, where is your studio? I said, you just stepped in. It could be, like I'm talking to you in Dubai or New York or London, because I am my studio. So nothing stops a creative artist. That's just how it goes. And if you want to see the lack of not having a camera, or not having space to work, then you're gonna get the block, right? I remember once I created, I was in Croatia, and I was seeing something so mesmerizing in front of my eyes. I didn't have my equipment on me. So I took my iPhone and said, let me do it with my iPhone, and later I will resolve the technical aspects, okay? So, and I did it, and the opening night of this iPhone shots in Dubai,
now.
Yeah, I remember once I was on a lake in Croatia, and I was seeing something happening in front of my eyes, art at the moment, and I didn't have my professional gear on me. So I said, what shall I do? I said, I'm an image creator. It's either I will write poetry about it, you know, to create images out of words, or I use my iPhone. And I told myself, I will later resolve all these technical aspects. And you know, these iPhone shots, David, were transformed into huge screens, projections from both sides, and exhibited in museums, okay? And when I made them as prints, I in Dubai, at the opening night, we sold at $85,000 of these prints. I'm just saying that one should never complain about your gear. It's all about how you approach things in life. A creative artist will always find a creative way, and that actually what inspires others to work with you, that you never stop. You never stop going forward, the thinking, reconfiguring, you know, re-looking at things.
I'm thinking of, there's lots of examples, I think. Francis Bacon, one of my favorite painters, springs to mind, who spent all of his wasted all his money on gambling and drinking. You know, the story. Right? And then he had to turn around canvases and he had to paint on the back without priming them. And that led to his amazing sort of very, very spontaneous painting style. And throwing rags at the pet, you know, it's a very physical. Yeah. Is that a page?
May I ask you, because of course your English is perfect and you have a great voice, unlike mine, you know, my accent sucks. Honestly.
No, it's fantastic.
Why don't you read Curse 28 and Curse 29, because they mirror each other?
Okay, like, okay. Curse so
28 and 29.
Okay, Curse 28, never carry an umbrella. Going for a walk, you see something inspiring and think the visual and what it triggered will linger within you forever. It won't. Then just as you lie down to sleep, another epiphany hovers above your head, and you let it wait till the morning to write it down. Upon waking, it's gone. Take notes. All of your ideas, your feelings and inspirations are like clouds. They keep moving, and before you know it, they shower on someone else.
Curse 29.
And curse 29, let it rain. Sometimes you have no idea where your great inspirations come from. When in doubt, read curse 28 and to never carry an umbrella.
Yeah.
I love it. I love it. Yeah. I was just going to show the anyone watching the YouTube who must get the book, obviously. Notice how Steve used something that you rarely see, I think, in standard prose literature. You see it a lot in poetry, where the font changes and the bold changes, so that he's like poetically emphasizing his points.
It's funny, I forgot to write the name of the font I use. This font comes in different shades or thickness or thinness. And while looking, guess what the name of the font is, which fits perfectly the theme of the book and what it wants to achieve. It's called Articulate.
Oh, Articulate. Yes.
It's art and it articulates extremely well my point. Yeah.
Is that a standard font that you can see on like Microsoft Word?
No, you can't. No,
there are other word processors.
Yeah. I think I got it from Adobe or something.
Yeah, you can.
I was lucky to find it very quickly. Yeah.
That's good.
But anyway, this book handles like on the middle, you asked like why the book has its colophon in the middle rather than at the beginning or the end.
Yeah, and just showing any viewers, you can see there's a dark line down the middle of the book, and that is basically the index and the title page and dates and so on.
Yeah, and I'm happy that the Lul Art Foundation, which is also amongst the biggest collectors of my art, supported and financed the publication of this expensive book. And I put it in the middle because I wanted like a story, the book. I wanted to start immediately, like with the curse, like artists are born, you know, like we go like Genesis chapter one, you know, and I'm an artist. I like to know the rules and I like to break them as long as I care about aesthetics. I mean, I'm an aesthetics freak, you know, I think art is, I mean, even though in my art, I have very hard topics I'm dealing with, but I like to do them in an aesthetic way. Like you can see barbed wire in my art. But you only see it when you come close. From a distance, it looks like Van Gogh or something, like Starry Night. But when you come close, you say, what is this about? You know, and suddenly it hits you in a different way. So I like the eyes to be impressed first, and then the intellect second. You know, in the end, you're doing visual art, not mind art, you know? But I like the mind art at the secondary level, you know?
Steve, when I do interviews, and I don't know whether we use this technique when you were interviewed for the ML business, but I did one yesterday, for example, and I show an image, but before I show it to the student, to the prospective student, I say, look, this isn't a test. I don't want you to identify this or the artist. If you know, I want you to not use your head anymore, because art history teaches you to lose your passion, I think, for art and to become too over-intellectualized. Obviously, if our students are going to go into the art market, they need to realize that a lot of people buying art are responding first with their heart, not their head.
Yeah.
So I get them to just talk about what they first see. And it's, you've just said the same thing, really, that you like people to respond, not to worry about anything intellectual or difficult in your work, but to actually just respond aesthetically immediately to what they see in front of them. But not just that, with a flat work of art, and I know your one in the Architectural Biennale is 3D, but you do, you know, it's important to be able to also get up close, and you often see a lot more. And I think the artist often intends that you see more when you get close. You're going to share another page or?
Yeah, I stopped the video.
Just for people viewing YouTube, Steve switched his video off because the bandwidth is a little bit problematic at the moment. So we're just going to listen to him now.
Yeah. Just maybe, I don't remember if we said to the listeners, the book is called The Artist Curse or Cure, yep, on being an artist, navigating the art market and the art world. Okay. And maybe 30% of the book focuses on navigating the self as an artist. It's never easy to live with a complex self, you know? I mean, many people say artists are crazy. So in my I had to find ways how to deal with craziness. I remember my first teacher in Musrara in Jerusalem. He said, Steve, you are crazy, but in your craziness, you are doing a great job. But in any case, you know, I also want to live at peace with myself. So this book has at least maybe 30% on navigating the self, on being an artist. And I think that's important, necessary to take care of ourselves, because if you want to live long and healthy, we cannot just ignore that part in our career, you know? However, the book tackles like important themes, maybe like not dealt before, like on the art market, on developing artistic and mental skills, on navigating the self, on patrons, collectors, and collecting art, on the value of art, on imagination, on purpose and essence. And let me just say something about essence. Some people think that you have one purpose in life. I feel you need to have multiple purposes in life. How can one settle for one purpose? I can't see myself one purpose. I mean, if you have many purposes, it becomes easier to achieve and fulfill some of them. If you have one and it doesn't work, you're gonna end up depressed. That's why I have many purposes in my life. Art marketing is also interesting. Like, how do you market your art, you know? Especially today with social media and what's happening. How do you go forward in this world where it becomes so much image-oriented? Do you just sit on your chair and let the art have a life of its own? It won't have a life of its own. Once an artwork is born, it has a life of its own. But the world we live in today requires you to be in certain channels so that people can see the art. If people want to buy your art, rule number one, people have to see it. I know some artists who create art and they put it in the drawer. Like, it's a great art, but I don't want anyone to see it. But then how do you want people to appreciate what you do? So now you need to think, where should I show my art? Is it online? Is it in a gallery space? Is it through reviews? Is it through talking with people? And so on. And the last themes in the book, it talks about towards artistic freedom, how to become financially secure, you know, doing your art, how to deal with your ego. And the best thing for me, one of the curses says, take a pin and inflate it. That's the best expression of ego for an artist. Even though we assume that artists must have ego like Picasso and all these things, but I feel in today's world, humbleness is the best way to go. It gives you more opportunity to work with museums, curators, collectors would love you, you know, if you're humble, rather than the other way around. And the last part is on towards mastership. And there are like a few curses or cures on that. And these require a practice of many years of practice, how to handle them. Maybe pick a number, David, and let's see. Pick a number. Let's see where it goes. From one to 365.
Okay, my birthday is 23rd. Shall I have a look?
Yeah, let's see what curse 23, right?
Shall I read it?
Okay.
When you work on it, this is back to square one.
Yes.
When you work on a new series, it's almost inevitable to be impressed by the power of the first two and then struggle to match their force as you continue working. This is because you start thinking of the process and technique instead of letting yourself flow like you were in the beginning. Only when you find the silence between your thoughts will you be able to immerse yourself in the colors of your canvas again. I love that.
Yes, absolutely. This goes back like to when I listen to music and get lost into my own space, to lose the self, to find a new self. So this is silencing the voices. Often when I, in the past, many series, like I'm so happy with the first two, and then I get lost for number three, four, and five. I get stuck for weeks and months, like, what's happening here? Why is it not working? And it has to do with I'm thinking too much. What I have to go back to intuition and work from the heart and the eye rather than from the mind.
Oh, and there's another page, which is like the year of my birth, which is giving that away. By the way, my dog is now, viewers will be able to see my dog who's trying to get a treat, I think. Anyway, this is interesting. It's called Void and Matter. Some artists believe they can only work when surrounded by positive energy. Fortunately, time teaches us how to cultivate negative energy and transform it into art. See the life work of David Hockney and how his art mirrors his reality at all stages of his career. Between void and matter, between negative and positive, imagine infinite possibilities for your art.
Absolutely, absolutely. And if the only thing you can exhibit on Earth, soon we're going to exhibit on Mars. It's like the space is infinite. Even like virtual space today, all the space. If people complain, why I'm not showing in museums? Can I just tell to these artists, create your own space and impress the world with visuals created through your own like virtual reality or augmented reality, whatever you want to call it, you know, and impress everyone. Good art will reach the world. You just have just to be persistent and never give up. Never give up, even though when you think it's over, it's only actually the beginning of something else, something new.
Yeah. Well, Steve Sabella, thank you very much for being the guest on today's podcast. It's been fantastic talking to you as ever. And every time I talk to you, I get a flood of new ideas, which always leave me feeling good and positive myself. So thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you, David. And always a pleasure to talk to you. And I hope to see you soon.